Next one is having difficulty talking about money or giving discounts to close the deal. And I see this in salespeople all the time. They offer discounts unnecessarily. Or even if you're in an industry where discounting is commonplace, I bet if you took a look at the salespeople that you had, you're going to find that many of them are giving discounts above and beyond what's normal, and they're giving them away unnecessarily. That's because they're not finding out the value, and they're not doing a consultative effort. Next example I had was assuming that clients buy the same way that you do. I see this all the time. Somebody says, let me back up a second. It's the way you were raised that influences the way that you sell and the way that you buy. So if all your life you put the coupon because money was tight and you went to school and money was still tight, and then you got out of school and you're still making good money but you're still clipping coupons, you may have the belief, and some of you may disagree with me on this, it's okay if you do, but you may have the belief that people have to get the cheapest or people have to get a discount. So be careful how your own mental conditioning is either works for you or against you when you're out there selling. And I'll give you a very specific example on this. I had a client years ago who sold the security services, guard services, protecting buildings, things like that. And they had two reps I'm thinking of in particular. One rep sold Lear jets to individuals, and to private individuals. So they're used to dealing with royalties from all over the world or big corporate executives, and they come in and spend $1 million at a pop, no problem. That guy could sell these security guard services without any discounting. They were typically $500,000 to $1 million contracts. He was used to selling at that level and never discounted. The other rep was a guy who used to sell VW Bug and other low-end VW. And so, you know, he's selling something for $20,000 to $30,000. Now he's got to sell $500,000 to $1 million contract. And when it came time to talk to money, about money, he would start choking up on it, because it was at a dollar amount he was not comfortable with. Now, the problem was the way it was interpreted. When you go to talk about $1 million and says, "What was it's $1 million," and he's choking on it, the message the client picks up is, this guy doesn't believe in his value. So it basically, it's set up to say, negotiate with me because I don't believe in the value that we offer, I don't believe in my product, ask for a discount, and guess what? He was discounting because he was choking on price every single time. Here's another one. A need to be loved versus a need to be respected. Now, again, we're still talking about mindsets and belief systems. There's salespeople who are, I'm going to call them the people people. You've seen them. The people can walk into a party. They don't know a soul. By the time the night is over, they're walking out. They're everybody's best friend. And they left everybody's card, and it's like, let's get together. Okay, those folks are great at networking, but if they don't have some things they're paying attention to, they can fill the pipeline, but they can never close a deal because their need to be loved is much higher than their need to do business. So they want to be loved more than they want to be respected. And the respect piece is, you know, I'd like you to like me, but listen, we're here talking about business. We're going to do a great job for you, and I'm going to stand by you every step along the way. We're going to stand by our word, but if we want to do this, you know, we need to get this thing done. Okay. Last piece I put down on understanding consultative selling is activity, and hopefully while you're there, it's at Jay's event, because it's how do you fill things in the pipeline? Now, to me, there's it's a philosophical discussion, because most companies have their salespeople do cold calling. And in my mind, the question is, would you prefer to have your salespeople looking for somebody to talk to or talking to somebody who's looking to buy? And if you follow what Jay's talking about and you're leveraging marketing and referrals and all that, you can have your salespeople busy spending their time talking to people who are looking to buy and see if you're a good fit. That's a much higher payoff. It's a better way to use a salesperson, and your profit margins are going to be much higher. If you're having your salespeople prospecting, they're really doing marketing and sales. They're probably not even doing a good job of it, and you're blowing a lot more money away than you need to be doing it. So that's the philosophy. There's another thing I want to talk about. Unfortunately, I can't see you all, so I can't ask you some of the questions that I normally do when I interact with folks. But there's a TV reality TV show out there called Pros versus Joe. And it's basically where they take a two or three guys from high school or college who no longer play athletes, but they're the and I say this lovingly, I don't say this in a demeaning way, but they're your friends who are the loudmouths who sit in front of the television Saturday or Sunday, you know, yelling at some professional quarterback because they're going, I could do a better job if I were out there. Well, in this reality show, they actually look for those guys and bring three of them in to play against five professional athletes. Now, here's the reason I'm telling you this story. There is a misconception among understanding what a consultative salesperson really is. In the Pros versus Joes, they take some guy three guys who have played football, basketball, whatever, in high school and college, and now every Saturday they go and play a pickup game for 10 years. Well, somebody would say if they played for 10 years pickup and, you know, 8 years of schooling, then they've got 18 years of what I would call experience. Well, when they put these folks up against the professional players, the baseball, the basketball, the soccer, the golf, the swimmer, the track and field person, and oh, by the way, of the five athletes they're up against, one is always a woman, and they constantly, all five athletes crush these guys, even though they haven't been playing quite as long. And the difference is not confusing skill and ability with longevity. So if some of you are going to go out and hire some salespeople, don't get lulled by the, enticed by the, oh, this guy or this gal has been doing it for 15, 20 years, they must be good. That doesn't make them a pro. Let me give you an example on this. Back in the 80s, before there was downsizing, here's what a rep would go through training-wise to learn their craft, their skill, to learn their profession. If you worked for IBM, HP, NCR, or Xerox, they all went through something very similar, and like this was the Fortune 500 before downsizing. First of all, you had to go to college, and if you didn't, they wouldn't even let you in the program. Second thing is you would go through 14 weeks of training just on product and corporate knowledge. No skills training on sales, being a salesperson, but we're talking 14 weeks. And then they'd put you in a technical position. So you would be a technical assistant, not even a salesperson yet. You would work then for 9 to 12 months as a technician, going out on joint calls. And once you made it through that probationary period, they would recommend you into sales if you met your requirements. If you were recommended into sales, you then went 4 weeks into what they called pre-sales school. And you were now promoted from a technician to a sales assistant. Then you would work as a sales assistant for 3 months, and you would go out with sales reps, and you would follow them around, and you would help out, and if you passed that, you would then get recommended to sales. If you were recommended to sales, they would send you to a two weeks in sales school, and you would be promoted to a junior sales rep. After that, you would spend 3 months as a junior sales rep, still on probation, and every week you would be with a sales manager, and he or she would sit down with you every week for 1 hour, taking a look at, are you sticking to our sales process, are you using your sales skills, style, accountability, coaching, mentoring, all those kind of things. Now, after those 3 months, you hit whatever was agreed upon goal-wise, they would then send you to 2 more weeks of professional selling skills and then promoted into sales. So basically, here's what it boils down to. It was 2 years of coaching, mentoring, and classroom training before you became an official salesperson. I did the math. It's about 40. Let's see. It's about 21 to 22 hours. Sorry, back up. 20 to 22 weeks of formalized training, and 80 weeks of coaching before you could become a salesperson, full-fledged salesperson. Now, here's the problem. The problem is, after they downsized in the 80s, no corporation stepped in to fill the void. So you've got a 20 to 25-year gap of salespeople who've been out there trying to figure out how to do it with minimal skills. And that's where I'm going to go back to the pros versus Joe's scenario, because we're finding out that these folks are calling themselves professionals. And again, I don't mean this negatively towards anybody, but I got to deal with the reality. The reality is you have people who've been selling out there for the past 20, 25 years, never got the coaching, never got the training, never got the accountability that they needed, and yet they've been in the business and they have longevity. Now, what's happening is the universities have started offering there's about 10 of them now that offer a minor in sales. They have 2 years of classroom study along with laboratory work, and they go into the lab, and the lab is basically, it's a telesales center. They're in there selling advertising for the school magazine, sponsorships for sports events, other kind of things. These folks have to get quota in lab. If they don't hit their quota in lab, they don't pass the lab, they fail the class, and if they miss quota three times in a row, they're out of the program altogether. But here's what's starting to happen, because about a year ago I met with 50 CEOs of Fortune 500s who were hiring sales reps from these programs. And what they all told me was, they said, Andy, what we're finding is we're getting these young kids fresh out of school. We're putting them on the fast track because they have the foundation. You know, they have the knowledge. They have the real world experience, and it's pissing off some of the more seasoned people. And let me correct that. Seasoned people meaning people with longevity, not people with necessarily great experience. But it's pissing them off because these younger folks who got all the foundation that they needed are outperforming those folks who are in that 20, 25-year gap. So I tell that to you so that you can start to manage your own expectations on, if I go and hire somebody and they don't have that 20 to 25, you know, if they're in that 20 to 25-year gap, you may want to dig a little deeper. There's a couple exceptions. The pharmaceutical industry has been fabulous on training their people, and they do a darn good job of it, and there's one or two companies that I run across now and then because, you know, they just believe in training their people. So that's kind of it in a nutshell, trying to give you all the meat of the thing without filling you with too much time on the telephone. So, Jay, with that said, what kind of questions do your folks have?
Does anyone have a question they would like to ask? I'll tell you what I'd like, Andy, and it probably would be beneficial because you're working your heart out and you're trying so hard. Our connection is still not great. If you would entertain letting me ask you a battery of questions, not now, but in a month or so when we start our conference call, follow-ups in advocacy of everybody, that would be like heaven on earth for me if you would be open to that.
Yes, I'd be more than happy to do that. We just have to, you know, find a way to make it work for everyone.
That would be good.
No problem.
Okay, with that stated, Andy, I will thank you profoundly from the bottom of all our hearts, and then go back to your seminar, and thanks for letting us interrupt you.
Hey, thank you, and I hope this was valuable for everybody.
Thanks,
there.
Bye.
Okay, yeah. Bye-bye, guys.
This recording was created and produced by Chesney Communications of Irvine, California. Copyright Abraham Publishing, 2006.